that, okay, to get onto the shift of this fibers, like so. And this is the anterior sheath. Directly underneath that would be your muscle, your rectus muscle. Okay? And the muscle should come up. it should come. That would be just there. Right? So if you make a cut here, that should get you into the peritoneal cavity. You won't be going through muscle, because if you've got muscles, it will be, and you lose the view. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Right. So, once you make the cut here, cross-sectionally, this is quite close. That's the sagittal view of that. Alright? Got bowel underneath there. And that's your grasper holding up. And you are looking at this angle. This junction here is this. Okay? So you make a cut here. Artery forceps to go through it. This is the shortest possible distance between outside and inside. Once you've made a cut, you pass your cannula, usually with a little balloon at the tip to hold it in place, and you will have maybe like this, and you have the gas port. Gas can go through and establish that. Alright? That's probably more straightforward than any slice you can find on Google. Because I can't find any slice talking about this particular region. Anyway, we've gone past that already. Now we need to do an appendectomy. Where is the appendix? What are the few ways that you could tell yourself to find the appendix? Because it won't just sit in front of you, right?
Identify the right colon,
yes.
And then follow the tenial coli.
Yeah. So it converges. There are three tenial coli, and it converges down to the base of the appendix. That's just brown midship. Alright, so you get tenia. It's sort of fanned out at the end towards the appendix. It's kind of disappeared. But you get another one on that side. You get one more on this side. Maybe a 12, 4, 8, and 4 o'clock position. But no matter where you look, it will still converge back into this area. And then your TI, usually there's a little valve here, just either single valve. And then your TI will come around like so. There's a avascular fold of fat here. Just means that you could use that as one of the guidance to identify as well. If you can't find it, or for whatever reason, your momentum's coming and plastered onto the colon, you don't want to dig around and diverting and causing diverting injury. there is a position
about, there's a variation of position on the appendix itself as well.
Okay.
Anyone can name some position. What's the variation of position? Good. What percentage? Good. Excellent. Well done. Okay, so that would be more that would be more common than this particular position. That's probably got about 65%. And it varies between whether it's, sorry, it varies between this way or that way, but it will be Brachial cecum. So what you need to do is to mobilize the cecum off the paraglottic upper fibers, yeah, incise the peritoneum here, and it's starting to roll the cecum off the lateral wall, and then you'll be able to review your appendix sitting. Usually quite inflamed, quite edematous, you know, quite difficult to differentiate between normal tissue and the appendix. Mm-hmm. So got to be careful not to dig deep, because the ureter is just going to, if you mobilize it enough, as your gonadal vessel, you've got the artery and the veins. Superimpose this, that image directly onto here, you see that the cecum is going to be sort of sitting around here. The appendix sometimes get really close to the gonadal vessels, so when you're grabbing it up, you need to be careful not digging deep. You stay on the appendix and try not to mobilize it too medial, because the more medial you get, likelihood of you hitting the ureter is higher. Notice that I actually deliberately draw the ureter behind the gonadal vessels. The gonadal vessels are your safeguard. If you hit the gonadal vessel, you hit that first before you hit the ureter. So it's kind of protecting you. Obviously you get bleeding, but better than ureteric injury. So that would be the plane that you guys need to know. Okay. You don't need to remember all the percentages on what position that you get. You get ileal, rachel, ileal, sort of put behind the terminal ileum, like so. You get, this is the pelvic, sort of pointing right there. The main common ones, I can't remember exactly all of them, but rachial cecal, pelvic, anti-ideal or rachial ideal are the main common places that you'll find them. Alright, and so once you've pulled up the appendix, any questions so far? Good, alright. So the first step to do the appendicectomy is to mobilize it so that you could lift it up. Have you seen one done before? In theater? No? Yes or not? Okay. I thought they didn't put any contrast into it. How could they tell? Interesting. 6 centimeters splitting angles?
No way.
I'll have to look at it. Has he got pancreatitis? Probably it's not going to do anything to it. Yeah. Well, yeah, have a look. Let them know and I'll tell them what you need to.
All right, thank you.
Cool. Okay, bye. Sure. There's your family hook. There's your grasper. Alright, so you're looking at the monitor. You're probably the assistant, no offense, but you start off. But that's the view that you should get for your surgeon, for your operator. Okay, when you're holding the camera. You're looking down like this, patient's like, you know, supine, maybe a bit of head down, rotated towards you so that the cecum would naturally roll away from the wall. And he or she will use the diaphragm hook and the grasper to dissect this area off. Well, at least that's how I do it. But some people like to start from here, which is called a skeletonization of the appendix. They basically just skeletonize the whole mesentery of the appendix serosa. There are pros and cons about it. If you start dissecting there, you're probably unlikely to hit the artery, because by the time this is not as close as I draw, this is basically further away and you get a plane here. So you can just drop the whole artery down without any significant tributaries or branches along here, because there will be some. Diaphragmic here, you'll just come across this, which is really minor, and you won't get bleeding. But this one, usually, you can't just diaphragm it, it will come back, and it's quite high pressure with the main end artery. So I normally just make a couple of windows, diaphragm it here, and turn it sort of the other way, diaphragm it back, make a window here. Use clips, go across, maybe two, and then just cut there. So that way you're confidently securing the artery here. And my way has one more advantage on that is I started right close to the base, so I don't have to worry about dissecting all this off the appendix, and I can just, once I've clipped it, sometimes I go really close. Once I clip it, I just need to dissect this bit of the appendix. And if you start seeing fibers going towards the cecum, you know, those serosal muscle fibers, you should stop. So if you keep digging diaphragm injury to the cecal wall instead of the appendix, so at that point, ask for an endo loop at there, and then control your specimen, and just cut there. So you get a 5 millimeter stump of the appendix. So this is the view that you should get when you're doing the appendix. Alright. This is a branch of the post-cecal artery, which is a branch of I
runs along here, giving all your junior branches. Alright. So it goes here. You've got what's the first branch of your SMA?
Call that, but sometimes it's the inferior pancreatical duodenum.
Yeah, because the arcade, pancreas, SMA, isolate process, and it gives an arcade supply, it unites with the superior pancreatical duodenum. So that's the first branch. But for the gut wise, is the middle colic, which is just here usually, just below the third part of the duodenum, because it will come up and supply the mesentery, it goes into the mesentery of the mesocolon. And then as it comes down along the root of the mesentery for your small bowel, you get the jejunal branches. Pretty big branches up there. Then your mid-jejunal, mid-ileal, then terminal ileal. As you turn around here, you can get the ileal colic there. Further up, you get right colic. Only 30% of people would have a right colic, a sort of substantial right colic artery. Most people don't. And the right colic, with ileal colic further divides into smaller branches to supply the cecum. Which is why, back to this picture, you get anterior supplying that, and then your posterior supplying the posterior pole of the cecal pole. And that also gives off the appendixial artery, just an end artery. You won't see arteries going anterior to the ileum, right? It's because it's coming behind around a single pond. Okay? So your ileal colic is there, right colic is there, middle colic divides into left and right. It's all joints with SMA. SMA ends with ileal colic. And the actual terminal branch of SMA is not ileal colic. You know where it terminates? No? Embryology? Rings the bell? What's macro diverticulum? You guys heard of that yet? Yeah? Heard of that? Macros? So what if you're trying to do an appendectomy and your appendix looks wrong? What are you going to do? Close? Get out? You don't waste a chance. You're trying to establish the diagnosis, whatever you can do with one operation. So sometimes your clinical diagnosis is wrong, and so you need to look around this area or even distant areas to see if that explains the pain. First thing first is you check if it's a female, so you go for the gynecological area to check for cyst, hemorrhagic cyst, endometriosis. If you've gone in and you're sure that you haven't caused any major bleeding and it's got a pool of blood there, it's usually retrograde menses and they can be quite sore, or ruptured hemorrhagic cyst. Yeah, make sure you lift up both left and right ovaries and have a look, take a picture. And then you look for the, well, you can point up and have a look at the gallbladder to see if the gallbladder looks thickened. And then you start running the small bowel to look for the macro diverticulum. And it's a little embryological.
Yeah, bit lined up, chorionic sac, teeth lined up. Basically,
that feeds the vessels
from the yolk sac into your gut. And then as your gut rotates between 270 degrees, clockwise, anti-clockwise, clockwise, 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 and anti-clockwise, 90 degrees, anti-clockwise, 90 degrees, and one more 90 degrees, so that your cecal pole ended up this part of the abdomen, not the other side. Sometimes if you've got bowel rotation, patient, you've got the cecal pole on the right side, not the left side, because they did rotate. Anyway, have a look. It's hard to explain
all that without the picture. But what I'm trying to say is this thing has the little feeding vessels going to it. It's the remnant vessel of the SMA origin. And that's what it takes, the SMA finishing at that point. And it's usually a structure that sits about 2 feet from the outer cecal valve. So you need to run the valve long enough. You can count, or you can just sort of run it long enough so that you're not missing it. Okay. And it's about 2 centimeter long. Okay. And it's on the anti-mesenteric border of the valve. Not on the mesentery side, anti-mesenteric border. And it's got 2% chance of a GIT malignancy growing in there. So it harbors some of your gastric tissue, mucosal tissue, or could be pancreatic tissue. And you get pain because they're secreting gastric content, acids, or pancreatic enzymes. Causing inflammation and irritation. And the tissue is usually around the neck of the diverticulum, like here, not too much at the fundus of it. And so when you're doing, if you do find it, and if that's the cause of this pain, there's no other problem, appendix looks normal, you need to actually excise this as a 4-week excision, not cancer excision, but you need to get rid of it completely. Some people are trying to do a wedge, like so. Two problems. You're either not getting the tissue clearly, or you narrow the small bowel movement too much by the time you finish, and you get the chronic obstruction. Okay, so it's an easy operation. Just, you know, take it out, pop forward, you join it back up. Don't try and shortcut. Okay. So that's appendix in a nutshell. Basically, if you've got no answers to your diagnosis, then you look for other things. And if you do have an answer, pay attention to the anatomy about what's surrounding it, and move on to the dissection by knowing where the artery is, control it properly, and then just look for this base. Sometimes you get told that, oh yeah, this is the base, but you're actually not down to this area yet. You're just sort of stopping distally, and you get stumped appendicitis. This remnant stump can get infection and inflammation again. So that will be really hard to treat. Mm-hmm.
So once you've removed the appendix,
mm-hmm.
and you've clipped the artery, how do you then like release the artery again? What do you stop the bleeding, if that makes sense? So do you leave the clips on? Or?
Yeah.
You just leave the clips on?
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Titanium.
So if you've had an appendicectomy there, then you...
You may have clips. Well, some people don't use clips.
Yeah.
Some people just burn it.
Okay.
And, or use manual loop to control it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But if you do have clips there, that's probably post-appendicectomy artery. Well, it depends on what other pathology is going on. If you're history suggest an ongoing chronic process, it's not a short duration of history of pain, and the appendix looks normal, then I would argue that that's probably the cause of the problem, and so you should resect it. If there's a clear appendicitis appearance, and you just found an incidental mangle on your thoroughness, okay, you just been thorough. It's just something I just want to run about, and you found it, or it had a piece in front of you. Do you really have to do that? Don't think so. You can leave it in until it becomes another problem. But obviously, you've got to have a appendix looking clearly abnormal, inflamed, you know, angry. That would be the source of the patient's pain. Because if you do an operation on the ankles, you know, any joints you form have a chance to leak. If you do it unnecessarily, the patient may have unnecessary complications as well. It's not complications free. The other things that you can have a problem with ankles later on is if you leave it in, it forms adhesions to the anterior abdominal wall, and you may have a band adhesion that your ankle's twisting around it, forming a bulbus. Or if you've got a mucus cyst, retention cyst within the ankle itself, because it's secreting mucus and it's not
coming back out into the small bowel, gets trapped in there, it turns into a blind-ended obstructive movement as an organ as well.
So that's why I often, if you're consenting the patient for appendectomy that has no other imaging to support your diagnosis, you should consent them by saying, you know, sometimes diagnosis can be wrong. There can be some surprises, either this or could be gynecological, could be, you know, cancer, Crohn's, things like that, that requires some extra resection or extra operation to fix. So you need to wonder. And sometimes if you really don't think this is an appendix, but there's no other way to solve this, and you take the patient to the ER, you should tell them, okay, I would take your appendix out if it looks normal, but you need to be aware of the risk of doing a normal appendectomy as well, because, you know, this stuff can fall off and you're having a leak. These clips can fall off and you have bleeding and hematoma. And you can have an abscess that requires further drainage, or inadvertently you can injure the cecum, you can injure the small bowel, you can injure the ureter. Taking an appendix out, normal appendix, it's not just taking an appendix out. It's about 2% risk of overall complications. So you do need to let the patient know. Because if they say, oh, well, I'm scared, I don't want that, then you can't take it out. The patient's not consenting to it. You're just doing a pure diagnostic laparoscopy.
So is there a higher complication risk if it's a normal appendix and you take it out?
No, it's not high, but it's still there.
Yeah.
Like, people say, oh yeah, that's, you know, what people wrong, just take it out. But it's not just taking it out. You need to know. The lab call is actually a lot more than the appendix.
Right.
And
we'll try to schedule next week then.
Yeah. And it's, oh, not next week. I can't be here next week. Next time.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Tyler.
All right.